goddamn soldier in there. Nobody stood up.
$20 fine. Now, I'm going to tell you, if bad language or foul language is something that offends you, you're in the wrong spot. Right? I make no apologies for being General Patton today. So, you've been forewarned. All right. Have a seat. General Bradley. General Bradley will be accompanying us today. He's in from 12th Army Headquarters. During this period in history, he was my boss. He wants to see how the 3rd Army is briefing. It seems that we forget to tell him where we're going till after we've gotten there, and he'd like to know ahead of time. So, sir, if you'll have a seat.
Colonel, sir, we're going to be starting with the G3, then the G2, then the G1.
I want to welcome everybody to General Patton's War Room. I am Lieutenant Colonel Weekly, the G3, your operations officer. This officer, I can kind of hear and see a little better, General. All right, sir, to start my briefing, we've been receiving some heavy artillery fire in the Hickory sector over here at Flynn. And the engineers on the bridge at Flynn were forced to withdraw their equipment while the Corps artillery fired 23 counter battery missions that reduced the enemy's artillery fire. They were hitting us pretty hard, so we did return some fire on that, and the engineers are back in place and on the bridge. Comet continues to improve the bridgeheads on the Moselle, for your instructions, I did have Red Irwin's troops head up there to help defend those bridgeheads at all costs. I told them they will not lose the bridge because you would be right there to square them, and they didn't want to be sent where they would be sent. And I think he understood your message, sir. Over the past 24 hours, Comet Artillery has fired 155 rounds of 155 artillery, 100 rounds of 8-inch howitzers, 25 rounds of the 240 howitzer ammunition. We're all fired on Fort Jean d'Arc over here, sir. And a number of direct hits were attained, destroying two casements and an ammunition dump. Additionally, after firing another 107 rounds of 155, the shelters and the casements at Fort Kellerman, the only result was just some chipped concrete. I mean, for some reason, they're pretty thick and they're hardened. So we're going to have to hit them with something a little harder, sir. Spitfire Pine Tree and Gangway missions in the Metz region destroyed rail marshaling yards and various military targets. I just got a report that we had 10 locomotives, 500 rail cars, rail track within 50-mile radius has also been destroyed. And I also captured another 10,000 gallons of German fuel. And that's all here around the Metz area, sir, is where that's all happening. I've also commandeered 45 2.5-ton trucks from the 53rd Replacement Battalion to move fuel. I also have drivers and assistant drivers for each truck from Colonel Blevins. Sir, these are more black troops. I got a report from Colonel Blevins that they were getting a raw deal from their commander, and Colonel Blevins asked if we could take care of them, and I assured him that we would put them to work and take care of them. That concludes my part of the briefing, sir. If there's anything else you have questions, what would you like?
Here's what I want you to do. We're going to need those rails to move troops.
Yes, sir.
So I want you to ask Opie Wyman, 19th Air Tactical Command, to locate the marshaling yards in and around Nancy. I think that will probably be our first town we'll be able to occupy.
Yes, sir.
I want him to go out at least 4 or 5 miles in every direction from those marshaling yards, whether the Germans have trained them or not, and destroy all the rail lines. I want them destroyed in a way where the Germans cannot use them. Because what we will do is once we occupy Nancy, I want to get that rail working so we bring our wounded all the way back to Paris. And the rail is the quickest way I know to do it. Once we get the wounded back, then we can start getting our supplies in up rail. The Luftwaffe is pretty well had. The only thing I worry about is saboteurs. So once these rail lines are secure, I want to make sure that we have troops take our anti-aircraft batteries and trace them along there They can also use for troop displacement and problems of saboteurs and see if you can guard that. Now, that's in that area. I understand it that one of the German commanders said that he had no intentions of surrendering. Was that one of those SS commanders?
Yes, sir. He said you couldn't take him, you would never take him, and he was going to fight to the death before he let you set foot.
Well, shit, I think we ought to erase that.
Believe me,
we have a whole lot of the German petrol that we got that don't run much of anything,
well,
don't we?
Well, we had 25,000 gallons, and I just captured another 10, sir.
And
35,000 gallons, sir.
Well, good. We can't put it in our tanks, but I'll tell you where we can do it. I want you to pump it all into some of our empty gasoline, trucks, sir. And I want you to take them down to Metz, and I want you to start pumping it in to all the vents there at that particular SS piece of vermin where he wouldn't surrender. I think he ought to get a second chance before we light him up. What do you think?
Well, sir, I think we should just flat give him a hot foot and to heck with asking him again.
I'll go with that. We'll just have a crowd barbecue.
I think we could have a really nice
one. I mean, after all, we gave him a chance, right?
Okay, yes, sir. We asked him one time. And
well,
he's
one of the goddamn SS party officials, so, you know, doesn't matter. All right, now let's see. You asked there was something else that you mentioned. Those bridges.
Yes, sir.
What's the second in command of that general's name? What's his name?
I don't have the deputy commander. I don't have his name.
You find out the deputy commander, Irwin's deputy commander, okay?
Yes, sir.
And you tell Irwin that we know the deputy commander's name in case he should lose one of those bridges. I think he'll understand.
I sort of explained that to him already,
well,
sir.
You think give him the deputy commander's name and tell him I'm looking into his personnel file right now.
Yes, sir.
All right. That ought to speed him up a little bit.
I'll have that done soon.
All right,
sir.
Thank you.
All right, that concludes my part of the briefing, sir. If there's nothing else, we will go straight to the G2. General, I have the G4s out.
You're going to do the G4?
Yes, sir.
Where's the G4?
He's forward, sir, taking care of things.
He went on that mission you sent him on, sir.
Oh, yeah.
You know, to the supply dock.
Never mind.
Yes, sir.
That's part of where those 45 trucks are, sir.
I understand. Go ahead.
General Bradley, General Patton, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Major Coulter. I'll be conducting the intelligence brief. We have the intelligence activities in the 3rd Army area have revealed the following enemy units operating within the 3rd Army sector. We have Army Group G under the command of General Balk, who recently replaced General Blaskowitz. Currently, the 3rd Army is operating as two field German field armies, which are the 1st Army, commanded by General Nobelsdorf, and the 5th Panzer Army, commanded by Lieutenant General von Montoifel. The 1st Army, or the Corps under the 1st Army, include the 13th SS Corps, commanded by Major General Price, and the 89th Corps by Major General Hearn, and the 82nd Corps, commanded by Major General Hornlein, who recently replaced Major General Sinhuber. The Corps under the 5th Panzer Army are the 47th Panzer Corps, commanded by Major General von Lutwitz, and the 58th Panzer Corps with Major General Kruger as commander. Enemy troop strength remains high along the front lines in the area of Metz through here. In some cases, resistance can be classified as fanatical. They are not giving up. Most notably at Fort Drian in the Metz area. General, my briefing is complete. Do you have any questions?
Yes. Several things I want you to do. Get a hold of Walton Walker, 20th Corps.
Yes, sir.
I want him to take, at least a division, maybe two, and I want him to move a corridor around Metz. Okay?
Yes, sir.
That way they will have no concept that they're not being surrounded.
Surrounded container.
Then that ghost unit we have, I want you to gradually at night replace them with the ghost unit. Tell Walker that I want a corridor open so I can sweep on down to Metz, and we'll go ahead and leave Metz there and do a cleanup of it later. I got to get on. I'm not going to stay any further.
Roger, sir.
Now, the other end of it is one of my corps has sweeped around now, and we're not far from town per se. There's a gap in there, and I want to have it caught. I want to close that gap. There's almost two German armies that we can figure that have not gotten through there.
Yes, sir.
Now, Montgomery has the other end of it. He's supposed to close that. But I want you to get a hold of General Gaffey and ask him to form a provisional corps. He used the 2nd French Army Division, and we have a couple others. And I want him to get him going and start him heading that way. And I got a hold of Bradley and ask him to get a hold of Ike and approve this thing. We got to get around Monty. He probably will never approve the damn thing. He's probably still tidying up the battlefield. Like, I told him they couldn't take Con at 10. Then he had that other thing. And now he's got this. We've got to, so I don't have to fight him again.
Yes, sir.
I'd like to wipe him out now.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Anything else, sir?
That'll do it.
Okay, the next briefing will be by the G1, sir.
I'm Captain Cale, G1 personnel. General, our current strength is 2,600 troops short. The 5th Division is short 440. The 35th Division is short 220. The 79th Division is short 770. The 80th Division is short 740. The 4th Armored is short 270. And the 6th Armored is short 160, sir. Replacement battalions are providing troops, but units are not reporting their arrivals on casualty reports, sir. G1 will be meeting with Corps G1s to ensure casualty reports are completed properly and in a timely manner, sir. We have the 90th Division requesting to be brought to overstrength, sir, from 100 to 200% due to strong resistance and casualties. This gentleman sitting here, sir. There have been reports of delay in mail delivery, and the postal section has confirmed with battalion commanders that the mail is delivered promptly or forwarded to the soldiers' new organization, sir. Major Horn and Major Elkman inspected the 53rd and 28th replacement battalion, sir, and found the oldest mail to be about 53 days old, sir.
Called the 90th Division. The 90th Division is one of the best damn divisions I've got. I want you to give them the replacements as quick as you can, okay? We're not going to get to them. Now, I've checked with the Acting General's office. We've got a whole shape. We went back to England. There are 20 black soldiers there that got arrested during that damn race riot bullshit, right? I want you to tell them to release them out of the prison and send them to the front. We need proof. You tell them to line them up here. You tell them that I'm going to put them back in their units. That stuff's going to be, if they keep their nose clean, stuff will be forgotten. It'll be sponged off the record. And what I'm thinking about it, I've been checking the records. There's about 1,000 troops we've arrested for one bullshit thing after another. Now, if they're not being held for murder, rape, or some serious crime, I want their asses released, and I want them back over here at headquarters. And I'm going to address them, and I'm going to tell them they're going to give them the same deal. Put them back into service, and keep their nose clean, their records will be expunged. I know some of them arrested for hitting an officer, not saluting, and playing craps and stuff like that. I need soldiers. Personnel, that reminds me. I heard 761st Tank Battalion floating around out there in the States. They've been it's an all-black unit. They've been running around with their tanks for almost 3 years now in circles. Hell, if they ain't trained by now, they'll never be trained. Tell them I want them sent. Bring them up here.
I will get right on, sir. I'll get paperwork done right away.
What else did you say? Mail. That's important. Men don't hear from home to say something's wrong. I've been right. I want you to get with General Lee and you find out why that mail is not being delivered.
Well, anything else, sir?
You've got it. Just about got it?
Yes, sir, I do.
That all of it?
That's all of it.
That all of it? You got one more?
I've got that.
All right, one more.
Our General, adverse weather conditions has precluded activity by Spitfire. 4 cargo planes overshot the airstrip at Baton. One of those planes, the Germans shot it down. three others were lost, sir. The result is out of the 20,000 blankets, 10,000 liters, 375 oxygen cylinders, Lucky only received 2,500 blankets, 1,000 liters, and 1,000 oxygen cylinders. I don't have the loss of those cargo planes. I don't have the complete numbers and what was actually on all those planes. I don't even know if there was fuel on them. The Air Corps hasn't given me those figures yet. I will get those to you right away. We also been advised by yield improvement priorities, our ammunition, food, and finally, POL at the end. The G4 doesn't think it's going to be a big issue on getting our replacements and equipment up here. I've also told maintenance to report any problems and repair everything, period. Everything, no matter what it takes, get it fixed by hook or crook. Our POL, sir, I just want to reiterate that those 45 trucks and crews are on that mission that you advised me to.
Hey, I got three priorities.
Yes, sir.
Socks, light, and hot food.
Yes, sir.
So if we can't get anything else in there, I want you to airdrop if you have blankets. It's raining, it's wet, it's getting cold. They need blankets.
Yes, sir.
They need socks. If they don't change their feet, they're going to get trench foot. We're going to lose about half of them because they can't walk.
Yes, sir.
And I want hot food. Now, you can tell our mess sergeants all the way down the line that I'll be popping in when I can, and I'm going to sit down and eat at their mess. And it better be top quality, or they're going to be manning a rifle, and I'll have plenty of replacements that way. General Bradley, sir, I think you see the situation as it exists here in Third Army. We try not to hold anything back from you. Well, most anything back from you, sir. Would you like to address and tell them what you are hearing from the Rough Army, Jay?
First of all, General, a couple of the things that I heard, you got to remember the whole situation. You want to be moving. Nobody wants you to move any faster or any farther than I do. But we got the whole picture to look at. And right now, as you know, just on the 22nd, meeting in retire with Ike, we don't have the priority of the Third Army.
And where do the priorities lie?
Right where we don't lie. Up there with Mike.
And what is Monty going to do with the priorities?
Nothing. We told him. But that's where I placed it. Market guard does not look like it's going to go anywhere any farther. This payment we've been having has postponed their latest airdrop reinforcement and replacement. It looks like that is going to be over. But we also know that the supply situation is the worst that it's been in the war so far. What's the biggest reason for that? Monty's priorities. He's up there in Netherlands trying to get through to the Rhine. He should be at Antwerp getting that open so we can get the supplies in at that port. Until we do, we're going to have supply problems. After we talked on the 19th, I talked to JC himself, General Lee. And he does say that the ammunition shortage looks to be getting better. But as far as your food, and your blankets and your socks and your POLs, that's going to take a while. So we have to prioritize. Ike is prioritized for money. We have to give most of ours to First Army because they have to move with money, protect his right flank. And we have First Army groups are already in Germany. 19 Corps on the northwest side of Aachen. 7 Corps on the south and west side of Aachen. And if we can take a major German city, even though it's not across the Rhine yet, it's going to be a big aid to the war effort. So, you know, the priorities are such. But both you and I at that meeting, when we talked there, it's what Ike didn't say. Monty wanted us to sit on our laurels and do nothing, go on the defensive. We don't have to go on the defensive, but we can't start any major offenses.
Well, let me ask you something. I've got to slow down. Can I reconnoiter ahead so in case we have some German troops out there?
By all means, you can recon all you want.
Good.
But no major offensives.
Oh, no, sir. We're just going to reconnoiter because I don't want any of my troops who are short of gasoline to be caught off guard if I know what's ahead of me. Is that all right?
Exactly.
Okay, I have your permission.
You certainly
you do. All right.
And as far as the gasoline in particular, the pipeline is working fine, and we have gas, but the transportation and the fact that we could get more if and were...
Our area between 1st Army and 3rd is pretty secure, is it not?
Yes, that is.
All your supply dumps and gasoline is pretty secure?
Yes.
They're still where you left it, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Which 1st Army gets most of.
Oh, I understand. Yeah. There'll be no one coming over there unless it's 1st Army. I got it.
Okay. And then, what we also talked about on the 19th, your idea of bringing all these guys out of the stockades to help with the replacements, that's a great idea. But with the supply shortages, how are you going to feed them? How are you going to move them?
We'll get them here.
But
we have a plan.
Okay, that's good. But we had talked about to help the supply shortage to take one of your divisions and give it to
Sir, Sandy you Patch. Remember what we did in North Africa?
Yes.
We ran the deuce and a half 24 hours. We went from where we needed them. We ran them 24 hours, sometimes 48 hours. When the soldiers were tuckered, we let them get out of the trucks and foot more. If I ran a lot of trucks from Normandy in with the gasoline and fuel, I ought to be able to get there with some of them, wouldn't you think?
Some, yeah, all right. Definitely.
Good.
But
we'll call it the Red Ball Express. What do you think?
Sounds like it.
All right, good.
But it still may be necessary to take one of your corps and move it to 7th Army, Sandy Patch down there, let him supply them, and then you'd have more supplies for the remaining corps.
I'd say.
Excuse me.
So you know, just the old soldier that I am, I'll always obey orders.
Yes, I know that.
So, I just wanted us to see eye to eye.
Yes. So, I need to go. Got to go talk to Ike before it gets dark.
Well, you say, like I said, hello, and I've got a turkey that we're cooking for him that was donated by the Germans, and I'll have it sent up to him.
All right. We'll do it, General.
General, sir.
Get a hold of the 554th Trucking Company.
Yes, sir.
I want them to, don't you have a supply of 1st Army patches?
I believe so, sir.
We still have all those stencils that mark our trucks with 1st Army?
Absolutely, sir.
This is called reallocation of available resources from one theater operation to another.
Sounds like a plan.
So you can get the requisition orders all signed up where they're from 12th Army Group, and the gasoline will be coming for it. Now, you tell that trucking company that I can't award them for this particular action, but I'll find something else, and we'll work on it that way.
Yes, sir.
And now, as far as getting the troops up, remember I talked about the Red Ball Express?
Yes, sir.
Well, I'll tell you what. I want every one of the deuce and the halves to have recruits on them as well, okay?
Yes,
so we'll get the gasoline, put the recruits on them, then we'll bring them out, we'll get them up here, then we'll drop them off.
Yes, sir.
We'll get two birds with one stone, so to speak.
Yes,
all right, now, this the conversation, of course, didn't happen.
What conversation, sir?
I like that, man.
All right, yes, sir.
And,
General,
yes.
Excuse me, we have captured a officer from General Noblesdorf's command. Would you like to interrogate him at this time?
Yes, it would.
Bring in the prisoner?
Feel great. Oh, he ought to be a little easier to talk to. You know, feel great or not, I just don't want to listen to this German nonsense. He wants you just to interpret for me. So ask him where the hell he was captured and how many troops was captured with him.
Yeah,
Walking through.
35 troops?
35 troops and
Does he have communication with the commanding officer?
Yes, the phone.
He said no, he hasn't, because he has been imprisoned by us.
Can he read a map?
Can he have a carte lesen?
Naturally.
Now, come over here a minute.
Yes, he said for sure.
Now, your unit's right about here, is that correct? Pay attention, I'm talking to you. All right. Now, you see that that unit's pretty damn surrounded, is it not?
Yeah, yeah.
See, our troops, you know, you can look at this, it's top secret, but you ain't getting out, so you can go ahead and look at it. All right, you see? Now, you can see we know where all your stuff is, too, right? So what you do, you send the message that you're in their intelligence, which I think is an oxymoron. Oh, you don't understand that. Anyway, you send their intelligence. You say they're surrounded. It would be goddamn easier if they surrendered rather than me kill them all.
Wir können nicht yet kapitulieren, weil wir haben zwei Divisionen SS hinter uns und sie schießen jeden Soldaten, der begegnet sich.
So he says they have two different units, SS units behind them, and whoever will surrender will be shot.
Can you get a hold of the 19th Air Tactical Command?
Yes, sir.
Do you think we can strafe those SS units long enough for these son of bitches to surrender?
Absolutely, sir. We just captured a new prisoner. They captured him a while ago.
There's one of them SS son of bitches right now.
He's the company commander of the SS unit in this area.
Why isn't he reached for our tracks? You speak English? Ask him what unit he is. 17th desert. Weren't you on the Russian front? Wasn't he on the Russian front? He was, wasn't he?
Ich weiß nicht.
He has no idea.
Yeah, they were. Don't we have those Russian interrogators over in the other tent? We do, don't we? And most of these assholes are wanted for war crimes, are they not? And the Russians would be happy to take out care of this prisoner, would they not? Now, I have a deal for you. Either you can help me out, or I'll send you to the Russians, and we won't see you anymore. What will it be? Now we're getting somewhere. How many troops were behind you? Do you know where his unit is? Would you like to know? Look here. Your SS unit's here. His unit is here. You're surrounded. So why the hell don't you surrender? You speak Russian too, don't you? Would you mind calling those fellows over? They might want to talk with him. After they have a few words with you, probably tomorrow before you can talk again, and then we'll talk again. Have a nice day. Did you get the point?
I miss you.
Send the message back when you can, or get one of your buddies, dude, that little corporal in Berlin, that when I get there, I'm going to personally shoot that son of a bitch. You know, the little corporal with the mustache that does this kind of crap, he's fine. Go do something with him. Since he's regular army, go ahead and let him have a good mess. Don't feed that son of a bitch. Now, if you think for a moment that what I just did was made up. It's not. That kind of thing went on. Now, we're going to have a little fun, because I know you've all heard a lot about Patton and stuff, and you have a lot of questions, and I want you to, well, kind of the fun of coming to these things and ask questions. Most people can't stump me, but every once in a while it happens. You're going to be the press corps. Now, when Patton gave a press conference, he could say anything he wanted to, and he had prolific language. He knew that part of it wasn't quoted because back in the States they wouldn't print that stuff. But the other end of it is that the PRO officer, public relations officer, that everything that the correspondents wrote had to be clear. So you could write anything you want to, and you give it to the PRO officer, and you go, nope, and you ended up about a half a paragraph, and you went over and started over. And all the photographs that you took were given, and they were taken to the G2 and the topographical units, and they developed the photographs. And then the PRO will go, yeah, that will work. Yeah, that one won't. No, not that one. Yeah, that one will work. And you may have taken the photograph, but since you were a correspondent, it belonged to the Army, because all correspondents were part of the Army back then. And so your picture that was perfectly fixed, everything you wanted, wound up in Look magazine and on the AP and a bunch of newspapers, and you got no credit for it. So that was just the way that it was. So Patton knew that, so he could sell you anything in a press conference and not worry about it. He could even tell you where he was going and not worry about it. So with that, you're now in the press corps, and you're able to ask me any question you want. So let's go. What do you want to know? Yes, sir.
Sir, I would just like to know your personal opinion of taking a perfectly good soldier and having him jump on an airplane.
Well, it's a perfectly good airplane, so, you know, it's a perfectly good soldier. Seems like a good match to me. But, in all seriousness, our airborne, we actually developed an airborne army. We had three of the airborne divisions, and they were able to jump behind the lines and secure places that we could not yet get there. So, they were probably the bravest men, and they fought all the way through, and there was a lot of casualties in the airborne. So, there are quite a few heroes involved in that. Yes.
How did you rescue the
What a wonderful question. Is she a plant? Wait a minute. Where did my goddamn phone go? Wait a minute. Let me get over here. This is a plug, by the way. Alright. Over here, in my book, which is for sale. Now, I can send you to Amazon, and it costs you $39.95 plus tax and shipping. But because you're out here and you've already paid a fee, for you it's $30 and I'll sign the darn thing. But in the thing, back here, I got a bunch of them. I have the story of the lip examiners. And I'm going to tell you a story, and the reason I got this is I'm going to read it. Because the Lipizzaner horses. Anybody know what the lip? Not know what the Lipizzaner horses were?
Yeah.
Most highly trained horses in the world. Their stallions were highly prized. Hitler had captured the Lipizzaner horses and most of the stallions, and he had a present he was going to give to Hirohito, and he was going to have one. But unfortunately, they wound up in the Russian zone in Czechoslovakia, and were getting close to the end of the war, and the 2nd Army, 2nd Cavalry Group, received a message from one of the Germans that the Lipizzaners were in their control, but there was a 2nd SS or ASS unit in between them, and if they could get the SS unit out of the way, they could deliver the Lipizzaners to Patton. Now, Patton loved horses. He thought they were some of the... He grew up riding horses, and to have a group of horses to become extinct, and that's literally what would have happened. The Russians would have ate them. I'm not kidding. So what he did is, and I'm going to read you something. This is the only time I know in any book this appears, and I was thrilled to find the article. This is by the 2nd Cavalry Colonel who wrote this. Now listen to this carefully. Toward the end of the war, Patton realized the Russians were our enemies, and he tried to keep them out of Czechoslovakia. Eisenhower had stopped his armies at the Czech border, and we had captured I can't pronounce the damn thing, but I ruined it. From Patton, and he sent the check board. The Lippensteiners were there. So he sent the 2nd Cavalry Group in to rescue the Lippensteiners. Now, here's what he told the 2nd Cavalry Commander. He said, I was told to get into Czechoslovakia as far as possible, then radioed that I was having trouble and surrounded and being cut to pieces. Then Patton would send a whole division to save us, and we would then try it again. So his plan was to rescue the horses, get the 2nd Cavalry Group, and this is by the colonel. It was done in 1963 when he had this article. It's a very rare article. And the idea was is to get them in there so that they could finish taking the rest of Czechoslovakia and keep it from the Russians. Now, the Russians found out he did have a slight fight. There's a movie that's semi-accurate called by Walt Disney. It'll come to me in a minute. And it's about the, you can get on DVD, I think, now, about the rescue of the Lippensteiners. And it's a wonderful story. And for you horse lovers, and I have a picture of Patton riding one of the Lippensteiner horses in this book that was meant for Hirohito. And he did rescue them. They have never forgot it. And when you go see a show for the Lippensteiner horses, they will remember Patton and his 3rd Army and the rescue. I got several pictures in this book of the Lippensteiners as they enjoyed it. Great question. That's the first time that question has been asked. I know we have a 90th edition, and that's why I mentioned him.
We also have the 761st.
Oh, okay. We have a true living hero among us.
All right.
We talked about the 90th Division. This man served in the 90th Division. They had one of the highest casualty ratings in Patton's Army. They were one of the most beloved regiments. I had the honor of attending the 90th reunion of the 90th Division about 6 or 7 years ago, and I walked among the nation's heroes, and one is here today.
Folks, you have a World War II 90th Infantry Division hero.
Yep.
Travis Smith here, home on me for the weekend.
Still going, huh?
About a hero from World War II to a today hero, right here.
Yeah, you want a picture of that? Yeah, come on over here. We're just to take a minute. This don't happen very often. In our lifetime, it may not happen very many more times, so let's enjoy it.
I
want
to be like this guy.
Okay, say whatever you guys say.
But I'm just glad the hell I'm standing here with him.
Yeah. How do you get it to take one more time? Do I just press?
Just keep punching it. It'll work.
It'll work.
We have it on videotape. We have a video recorder that's recording all of this. All right. And Travis, congratulations. Travis and Travis.
Unit was in the woods in Normandy, and out of nowhere came 2 individuals. At the time, I didn't know who they were. One was General Patton and his pilot, Captain Cotton. They came up to our medical jeep, and the general said, take down the flag, and get the driver out of there. And he took the jeep gone, and he visited different headquarters. Then he'd come back. Nobody knew when he was coming back, because he'd sneak back, get into his Piper Cub, and fly back to his headquarters. That was a secret thing. I never knew it was him until after the war was over.
You did well. Have a seat. Well, I'm busy with this. Travis has got, he learned a lot of stuff he shouldn't learn from me. So everything that I do here, please don't do it in the service. Damn sure stay off the goddamn Facebooks. You're not going to make it out of the service if you don't. All right. I'm so damn proud of you.
Oh, wow.
All right, back to the story. I like it. Okay, you got any more questions? That's the damn good. Yes. Yes, I was. I'm in Stockholm.
Triathlon.
I did great. We did find the horseback riding, everything else. We got to the pistol shooting, and I was shooting a 45 revolver. I was an excellent shot, but back then they didn't put a target behind the target. So, you know, if you had a ragged hole, you could actually shoot one through the hole and wouldn't know it. But if you had a target behind it, you know that you hit. So I shot 10 beautiful rounds. At least I thought they were 10 beautiful rounds, but they said I missed the target. And so that's what kept me from winning. But I represented the United States in the 1912 triathlon, and I one of the medals that I wore on my uniform represented that. And my people, not many people know that.
And
in 1936, Thorpe was fantastic. He embarrassed that little paper hanger, did he not? All right. Next question. Yes, sir.
How did you die?
How did I die? Well, I took my time about it. I knew that was Pat, but he was careful how he phrased it. Pat was not murdered. If you want to make a lot of money, you can leave out a lot of facts, and there's four different books suggesting that he might. So I'll tell you the true story. I'm going to have to go quickly because it's a long story. He was getting out of the Army, 60 years old. He was tired. He was pissed. He was going to write a book that would curl Eisenhower's head. And he'd already sent a lot of this book home to Beatrice. So Hap Gay, who was his chief of staff, major general, and his best friend, suggested to him, look, Sunday is your last day here in Germany. At that time, he's the highest ranking officer in Europe. Eisenhower's home, Bradley's home, he's in charge of the whole thing. And he said, why don't we go pheasant hunting Sunday? Now, this was Saturday night. He hadn't even made up his mind. He was in a bad mood. And so he thought, well, maybe we'll do that. So Horace Wooding was his driver. And Horace was out partying like any young fellow would in Germany, and he was fraternizing, and he got in with quite a hangover. And so the next morning, he gets a call like 5:30 in the morning to go up and warm up the general's Cadillac and the weapons carrier and get the other guy with a dog, and they were gonna go peasant hunting. Now, Patton didn't quite know exactly where he was going to go. He just thought he'd go on the other side of Manhattan and go peasant hunting around where they'd peasant hunted before. And so they get in the car. It's really cold. The dog is in the weapons carrier, and Patton is in the front seat, and Hapgay's in the back seat. He saw the dog was cold, so he got the dog out, put the dog in the front seat of the Cadillac. He got in the back seat, and him and Hapgay began to have a conversation. They passed a set of ruins he hadn't seen before, castle ruins, and they stopped. And they went and looked at that. He got back in, he wanted to see if a friend of his was there, and they were down the road, so he stopped on there. Then he got back in. Then down the road, he ran across an MP, and all the MPs were told to stop everything. Now, the MP saw four stars on this thing, and you know, you can imagine. So the MP stopped him, and he came out and said, Pleasant, sir, I need to see your identification. Patton loved it, because the man was following orders. So he got out, gave him identification, told him he was a good job, and got back in the car. They took the Autobahn, got to Mannheim, and Mannheim was a mess. There was work going everywhere. It had been bombed out, so they had to move around to different areas and find ways. They came to a railroad track, which was an ordnance depot on the other side of the railroad track. Just as they're crossing, they're going about 20 miles an hour, and just as they're crossing the ordnance depot and the railroad track, a deuce and a half takes a left turn tries to get into the ordnance depot and clips the front of Patton's car. He's going 20 miles an hour. Truck's going about 20 miles an hour. Did no damage to the deuce and a half. Tore up a little bit of the front of his Cadillac. He was sitting on the side of the seat on the forward. He went forward and cut his, and hit the, there's a plexiglass or glass partition between the front seat and the back seat, and it has metal around it. He hit the top of it and went all the way down to the bone, but it broke his neck. Didn't kill him, but it broke his neck. And so the accident was a pretty loud little accident. MPs were there within a couple of minutes. They saw what was happening. He was conscious. He asked Hapgay to move his hands, and he couldn't. And he did, but he couldn't feel it. And he knew he was paralyzed. And he knew that truck driver who had come up and was just beside himself said, look, you don't charge that man with anything. It's an accident. Now, he's the highest ranking officer in the European theater. When an MP heard an order from him, and verbal orders were used a lot back then, and it was Patton, you did what you were told. So he didn't make an accident report, an official one. So, but all this is known. This is not secret stuff. I'm telling you, it's been in books for years. So he goes, and the ambulance heard it, flagged one down. They went to the 130th Hospital in Heidelberg, which was under 7th Army control and a good friend of Patton's. As soon as he heard about it, and all the reporters and generals and people watching, he cordoned off the entire hospital. Then he cordoned off the entire ward, and they rushed down, and they took a x-ray machine, which was a huge thing, and they brought it downstairs. They cut the uniform off of Patton, and they gave him x-rays. They knew immediately, for most men, that that was going to be a fatal accident. It wasn't that he was going to die, it was just when he was going to die. But Patton was a tough man. And there was just a little bit of a twinge in one of his toes, or so they thought. And if that was true, that means he wasn't completely severed. So they knew how grave it was. They got a hold of Colonel Sperling, who was the best they had in the States. He was fixing to muster out of the Army, and they grabbed onto him. And they got Beatrice Patton's wife, flew him to Germany in a snowstorm, got her there. And for the next several days, they put him in hooks, which were Crutchfield devices. There were hooks with the weight went all the way to the back of the, and they came down with like fishing weights, and he was stuck like this, super painful. But they felt like if they kept him straight, that he would not, maybe had a chance of that really being something to having that twinge in his toe. He began to cough a little bit, and they were afraid that he was going to do something to his body. So they plaster cast him to take this out. So he's sitting there in a plaster cast, laying there. He could talk, he could eat, he could joke. They even ran some booze in for him to take. It wasn't bad for him because it thinned your heart blood. And Beatrice read to him every day. At no time was that man alone, period. He either had a nurse with him, several doctors. The food was the same food that came out. It didn't kill anybody else. It wasn't going to kill Patton. He was there with his friends. Nobody got in to that hospital room. Nobody. And they watched it and watched it. Beatrice was reading to him on the night of the 21st of December. He was tired. So he began to go to sleep. She quit reading to him and went down the room. The nurse in the room, 24 hours, nobody left him alone. The nurse in the room saw something was different and saw that he quit breathing. And they called her back down the hall, and Patton was gone. Now, Beatrice later heard some of the rumors, and she, now I'm going to tell you, do you know who Frederick Eyre Jr. is? I doubt it, most people don't. That is Beatrice's brother's son. That is the nephew of General Patton. Do you know what his job was in World War II? He was the bureau chief for the FBI for counterintelligence in the European theater, and answered to Ike, and he loved his uncle. Now, who in the hell do you think investigated, who briefed the interest asked to investigate any rumors? And don't you think for a moment that if he had found anything, he'd have said something. It didn't happen. Now, about 10 or 12 years later, there was, maybe a little bit longer, there was a OSS officer who got drunk at a reunion, and he stood up and he says, General Donovan paid me $10,000 to kill Patton, so about the truth of Eisenhower wouldn't be let out in other stories. General Donovan was a World War I Medal of Honor winner, and he was a good friend of Patton. But the guy was drunk, he didn't want to lose face, he kept the story. So later they made a movie called The Brass Target, and they had this broken window in the Cadillac, and they shot him with a rubber bullet, and later there was another movie, and then finally Bill O'Reilly ran out of people to kill, so he killed Patton again. Patton was not murdered. And Thompson, whose name is known for the rest of his life, regretted and told many people, I'm the guy I ran into Patton and I helped kill Patton and it ruined his life. Horace Woodring was interviewed time after time. Hap Gay, who was in the car, said it was nothing but an accident. If you would really like to read the real truth that was written by somebody who knew everybody at the time, you read The Last Days of Patton by Ladislaw Farrago. Later, they made a TV movie based on that book called The Last Days of Patton. If you don't read, you can buy the video. That is as close to accurate as you're ever going to get. Anything after that is bullshit. Now, whew, that's a long question.
You sounded kind of hoarse, sir.
Yes. Are you calling me a horse? My horse is ass. I'm not the whole horse.
My mistake, sir.
Oh, is he here?
He's here,
yes, sir. I've got him.
Bring him in. Bring him in.
Sergeant Perry.
Now, wait a minute, I'm being horse's ass. Okay, there we go. Now, face the crowd. We're in a living history out here. You saw the real heroes, then you see people who remember the real heroes are not supposed to, not here for themselves. I told you earlier, and I wasn't bullshitting when I went through the 761st, right? It was a black battalion, they called them a colored battalion, or a Negro battalion back then. And they were running around in circles. They were probably the most highly trained troops we had because they've been training for 3 years. Patton found out, what the hell are they doing in the States? Send the son of a bitches. Not that you're a son of a bitch, of course. And so they got together and they brought him up and he looked, went over and said him. He said, look, I don't care what your problems are. I want good soldiers in my army and you're going to be good soldiers. So I want you to go out and kill the goddamn Nazis and keep killing them. And you do that, you won't have any problems with me. He said other words, that close. Didn't he?
Yes, sir.
Now, you read the book, haven't you?
No, sir.
You need to read the book, Patton, 761st. Anyway, he's going to tell you, because he's a living historian, tell him about the heroes you represent.
I represent a group of people who went under tremendous adversity. And, you know, they were thought of, you know, lazy and, you know, they can't do this, they can't do that. And then they ended up running circles around everything. So, I mean, it's kind of the true testament of don't judge a book by its cover. So, and it's a great honor to represent these men.
That's why we do what we do. I want you to buy the 761st Black Panther, the book. I want you to read it. Next year there's going to be a test. Thank you. We have an 80-second hit board?
I've got a question.
Wait a minute, we got a burner. Who's the 80-second? I get you.
80-second, 508 PIR.
World War II?
World War II.
Bless your heart. You when you didn't want to be rescued, right?
We're always surrounded.
All right. General. Okay, the question behind.
Yeah, your horse cavalry training.
I'm sorry?
Your horse cavalry training. When you became a tank commander, did that horse, your early training with horses, was there anything to apply forward
from the horse training? Hell yes. All right, you've always heard Patton was a horseman and a cavalryman. He learned something. He said, do not take counsel of your fears. Now, do you know what that means? When he was a young lieutenant, his job was to train new recruits on horseback riding. Now, he was an expert horseman and polo player and everything else. But, you know, when you come into the cavalry and you're not a very good horseman, you get to learn for yourself. So they would go on the top of the hill and they rode remounts, which meant that these were horses that had been in the cavalry quite some time. You couldn't hardly spook them. And they would get to the top of the hill and they would go down at a 45 degree angle. That meant the horses would back on their haunches as they went down. Then they had to cross the river, come back, recross the river and go back up. Now, any of you who ride horses know that if you're not a very good horseman and you get afraid, you start shivering or you keep worrying and the horse catches onto that. He says, hey, I got a goofball here, and they won't do what you say. But these horses weren't that way. they were trained to the bugle. So all he did was tell the first sergeant to blow the bugle, and the horses went because they knew the bugle call. And then they went down the hill. And so the horse hit up. And they got all the way down. Then they got on the river, and the river was deep enough that they could drown. So they had to hold on to the horse's tail, get across, get back around, and get back up. And they did it. And they said, let's do it again. And they did it again. And about the third time, we had to stop them. We said, we got to rest the horses. Now, the difference between the first time and the last time they did it was they were no longer taking counsel of their fears. They were trained. A fireman, a new recruit, doesn't go into a building without being trained. So if you take counsel of your fears, probably, you're not trained. So he trained all of his men to the point that they no longer took counsel of their fears because they knew what the hell they were doing and they were no longer afraid to do it. Now, that doesn't mean they weren't afraid. Fear comes to everybody. Pat wrote a poem about fear. But being afraid is a natural thing. Courage is overcoming the fear because you know how to do the job and you do it anyway even though you're afraid. That's courage. We see it in police officers, we see it in firemen, we see it in paramedics, we see it in soldiers. They know it's dangerous, they're trained, that's their job, and that's what do it. So if you want to point to a real hero, you point to them. Forget those football and basketball stars and movie stars and all that crap. They ain't in danger. A real hero protects you. Now, what was that?
This gentleman here has a question for you, sir.
Okay.
Is it true that your tankers wear shirts and ties?
Did I make my what?
Your tankers. Your tankers.
My tankers wear shirts and ties?
Not shirts and ties.
Shirts and ties?
Yeah.
They wore ties, okay?
Yeah.
More so, not in the field. That's a nice call. They did wear ties and had to wear the helmets.
I thought we had not in the tank.
They did. That was the school. He knew when those tanks got hot and they took everything off.
Yeah.
But he also knew when he rode by them, they put everything back on. So, yeah, but the standing order was they wanted the men to feel good about who they were, and wearing a tie did that. He wanted the helmet more because he didn't want any casualties. And he wanted strict discipline. That's right. Any other questions?
Sure.
Yes.
Staff Sergeant Betts, 818th. Take the story of battalion. I understand you took on Rommel, and you also read his book. What do you think of Rommel, sir?
Okay, first of all, I didn't take on Rommel. I took on his plan. He'd already,
yes, sir.
He already gone back to Germany. What I think of Rommel was best in the hand. I did not read his book until after North Africa. His book hadn't even published that. They took an original German publication, they republished it in English, and I didn't get a copy of it until August of 1944. When I read the book, I read the portion of 1914 when he attacked during the raid, and he did a raid attack at night. I had an operation on the 9th of November where it had rained all night, and I was wondering whether I should call it off. I read that passage in Rommel's book, and I said, to hell with it, and we're going to attack that, whether we had air support or not. That morning, the attack went off, and we were victorious. That's the true story.
Thank you, sir.
Another question down here, sir?
Yes, sir.
Why ain't all these movies like that?
Ah, another question. Where's my book?
I know it.
And he has his speech. And he says, no bastard ever won a war by Niagara country. Did he ever say that in the speech? No. Never. He was talking to General Gavin one night in a meeting, and he said, look, no bastard ever won that war but died for his country. We make the other poor dumb bastard die there. But Gavin told that to the producers of the movie, and they put that in the speech. Now, in my book, I love these questions. You did good. In my book.
Well, as part of the movie.
Wait a minute, I'm answering the question. What is it?
Don't interrupt that.
All right. Wait a minute. In my book.
Yes, sir.
In my book, I have a picture, several, of Patton with all his medals. So in the movie, George C. Scott stands up as a four-star general and gives this speech. First of all, he gave the speech in England, and he was a three-star general. He didn't wear all the medals but one time in his entire life, and that's because if he didn't, Beatrice was going to knock him over the head because he was at Hamilton. She says, you got all these medals, put them on, we're going to take a picture. The reason she did is because Pierre Johnson, a doctor friend of theirs, had a camera that had color film, and she could get a picture. So the pictures were taken of him in all the uniform, and he was a four-star general when the picture was taken. So Frederick Ayer Jr., and we now know who he is, wrote a book called Before the Colors Fade, and he used that color picture on the front cover of his book. So when they made the movie and they saw that picture, they go, wow. Now, the speech was anticlimactic. George C. Scott was a drunkard. He didn't want any, didn't show up half the time, and he wanted to put the speech at the end of the movie. And they said they couldn't really argue with him. So they filmed it at the end, cut it, and put it in the beginning. And then they put this speech in here. Now, I had just happened to have a picture of George C. Scott. And you'll see in red of the movie speech of the stuff that he didn't say. So we have a movie where a man gives a speech that he didn't give and a rank that he didn't give, saying things and things he didn't say in a uniform he didn't have. Other than that, it was accurate. We have, if you really want to know what Patton really, I'm not done. If you really want to know what Patton's real medals were and how he got them, these are photographs in here of his real medals from the Patton Museum and exactly what he earned and when he earned them. Okay? Now, and the book is for sale, and it's over there.
All right. I need you right now, stand still, close your mouth, you're drawing flies again. I need you to make a presentation.
Okay.
In regard to a World War II veteran.
Okay.
And bring the gentleman in.
Okay.
And the gentleman has to make a presentation.
Okay.
This, your folks,
that's why I have
this.
A chief of staff. He's the only one that talked to me that way.
There you go.
All right. Oh, yes, I remember now.
Sir.
Yes.
That's important.
All right. You're going to, for your gentlemen, you're going to tell them what they are.
Okay. Jonathan Stevens, up front forward. And his son. Stand over here.
Come on in, guys. This is, you're going to love this, folks.
Boris Muzz, both you sons, come over here. Up front, center. These sands were taken on November 22nd, 1985. 70 years after your dad fought the battle.
Wait a minute.
Hang on. All right, now try it again.
Go ahead. Jonathan Stevens, you have been honored today by being a colonel, promoted. Congratulations. And here's some sand.
They don't know what it is because the goddamn plane went by. Tell them what it is.
It's the sand on the beach, Red Beach 2. Where his dad fought, and
now we know.
After 3 days, they won the battle.
Okay, did you understand what he said? Please, raise your hand if you didn't understand.
D-day.
Okay, your father was a veteran.
Yes, sir.
He fought where?
Tarawa.
He visited there. He picked up the sand where his father was, and he's presenting it to him. That's what he just said. Let's give him a round.
Sidon Howard. His dad also fought at the battle at the same time. He lost his eyesight. And I'm also presenting the sand also. Here you go. Thank you for the service. Thank you, sir.
You're most welcome.
Thank you so much.
Now get the hell out of my Kansas Christmas piece.
And it's Tarawa.
All right. We got time for a couple more questions.
I got one more to finish, though. If I ask you one question, you give a good answer. Why did the movie make Patton look so bad, like crazy?
Because,
and there was nothing wrong with him.
Because the movie
won the war.
Okay, I'm going to give you the truth.
Okay.
There's two books that they used. The Patton family refused to participate in the movie. They used something in Triumph. Okay,
Ordeal and Triumph.
What?
Ordeal and Triumph.
Ordeal and Triumph, a lot of Slot Farrago, and they used a soldier story by General Bradley, Omar Bradley. Bradley's wife had remarried because his first wife had died, insisted on getting equal billing in the movie or she wasn't going to have them sign the book. It took them from the 1950s to 1968 to make the movie. They had problems with Montgomery because they were afraid he was still alive. They were afraid he was going to sue him, but they put him in too bad a light. Eisenhower refused to be in the movie, so he's not in the movie. Oscar Koch, who was the G2, who actually had predicted the Battle of Buzz, refused to be in the movie. So did the assistant G2. So did Hap Gay. None of them wanted any part of it because they were afraid it was going to be a hatchet job on General Patton. So what they did is they put the perception of persona of Patton into the fabrication. If you want to read the real truth of making the movie, you buy the book, Making Patton, and it will tell you how much of a farce the movie really is. He was not that way. There's your answer. Okay.
Thank you.
Yes.
How much did you make per month?
What?
How much did you make per month?
I don't remember how much he made per month, but it wasn't much. But he gave every single dollar he ever made in the Army to the old soldiers' home. His wife's father was independently wealthy, and when he died, they inherited that. His father was semi-wealthy, and when his parents died, they inherited that. So he didn't need the money. He was a soldier because he wanted to be. He never took an ounce of Army pay, ever. And so he was there because he wanted to be a soldier. From the time he was a little kid, he wanted to be a general. That was his calling in life. He wanted to fulfill it. He wasn't the mean ogre like you. He would cuss at you and be up and down. But let me tell you another couple sides of Patton that most people don't know. During the Depression, a lot of the soldiers were worse than indigent. They weren't thought of very well either. Patton grew up in an army where he would see signs when he would go into town that said, no Indians, no dogs, no soldiers, but not in that order. They hated them, okay? So you had the dregs of the earth, you had good soldiers, it was all mixed up into one. But he loved soldiers. He thought they were wonderful. He understood what they were given for their country. Every once in a while, he would hear of a soldier who was so down and out that he had nothing. He would arrange for his dog to get lost, and he would put a reward for the capture of that dog. And he would make sure that soldier found that dog so he could get the reward. That's the real Patton. There was the Patton who, during the Battle of the Bulge, he heard that one of his cooks had, there was a German train that had a whole lot of German food on it, and it was shot down and it went into a ravine, but most of the food was salvageable. It was against Army rules to give any food of any kind to the civilians, or you'd have camp followers following you because most of Europe was destitute. But he had a cook who got a lot of that food, and he had a nunnery over there, and the nuns were running an orphanage, and they had hundreds of kids who had no food at all, and he made sure that those kids and those nuns had that food. Now, Patton's MPs were following orders, and they arrested the cook. His name was Blackie, his slang name. His real name's been lost to history. And so he brought Blackie in front of his, and he says, Sergeant, am I to understand that you've been giving food and contraband away? Yes, sir. And do I understand that this food was captured food? Yes, sir. And am I to understand that it went to the nuns? Yes, sir. What do you have to say for yourself? Sir, they were orphans. They would have starved to death. This was the only food they were going to get. And the Germans didn't need it anymore, and it didn't come out of our soil. He says, you know what? I demand excellency, and I demand following orders. From now on, if you do anything like that, make damn sure you don't get caught. MPs, make damn sure he doesn't get caught again. This day, they light a candle for that. You see, that's the real Patton. That's the real man. There was another incident during the Battle of the Bulge, and his troops were a little afraid of him. And one of the officers had scheduled a drop to come down and bring supplies at Bastogne. And we gave him the wrong coordinates and dropped him in the German area, and Patton heard about it, he was furious. Now they're in a wooden building in Luxembourg, has wooden floors, and Willie the dog could be heard coming down. And the dog stopped in front of the officer's door. He goes, oh no. The dog, the door opened, the dog came in. He knew who was coming next. So he just said, yes sir. And Patton looked at him. He said, you know why I'm here? Yes sir. Why am I here? Well, because, sir, the food dropped in the wrong place. I didn't go to where it was supposed to go, but I made it right back for this, and then it landed where it was supposed to go, and everything's okay now, sir. The Patton returned to salute. He says, son, are you afraid of me? Yes, sir. He says, are you married? No, sir. Well, look, when you get married, you'll soon lose any fear you ever had of me. You see, that's the real path. So, what I challenge you to do is read, understand real history. The movies are there to make money. There'll be a killing Patton. There'll be all kinds of other stuff later. Most of it's bullshit. Learn the truth. If you want to learn about the real, what happened to Patton, read The Last Days of Patton. If you want to see an overview of Patton, there's a huge, thick book of called Carlos Diaz, is the genius of Patton. There's an older set of books called The Patton Papers that go into Patton's early life and his history. There's another book called Lieutenant Patton about what he did and the punitive expedition. I mean, it's all over there. Find good books with good bibliography sources. Don't buy any of this new garbage because it's there. Not all of it. It's there I got to be careful here. I put myself in the corner. I have a 3-volume book coming out. Right now I have the photo book, which is the 4th volume. And it's designed for young people to read it. Well, it's got bad language like I use. It has concentration pictures in it so we don't forget. But it tells, it's a photo book. So, those of you that don't read a whole lot, you can sit on your favorite place and read the thing every once in a while. The first chapters you read and go on. Now, those of you that don't have any money, and that's okay. I've enjoyed all of you coming here. I hope it has been pleasurable for you, and I hope you will all come back. We've got it one more time tomorrow. Tonight we've got a dance, and I'm going to wear that uniform that he only wore once. We're just going to have a good time. And thank you for taking the time to learn history and coming. It's very special that you're here.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.